Welcome to Mount Prospect Public Library's Library Life. I'm Kathy Cushing. Today we'll peek in on an interactive youth services series promoting playtime at the library. We'll also explore the life and accomplishments of one of America's most celebrated composers, George Gershwin. And we'll take a virtual trip to Ireland with a visit from the Dennehy Irish Dancers. But first, let's enjoy a round of golf, mini golf, at the Mount Prospect Public Library. If you heard the word four uttered in the library recently, you may have been witnessing the Mount Prospect Public Library Foundation's second annual mini golf event.
We're raising money with the mini golf fundraiser. So the proceeds will go back to the library to sponsor programs and special events, as well as projects that need to be done in the library. It was a brainstorming idea that came about 3 years ago. We had heard that other libraries in suburban Chicago had tried this event. So we attended their events and started investigating the success, and we thought we'd give it a try. When we did it last year, we had so much positive feedback from the golfers that came and participated. Families, children, senior citizens were here, and they all loved it so much and asked us to bring it back, so we decided to do it again.
Mini golfers here at the Mount Prospect Public Library wind their way around a course designed to allow for challenges as well as the appreciation of literary scenery along the way.
We have an 18-hole golf course, miniature golf course, set up throughout the stacks of the library on both floors, first and second floor. What this gives an opportunity for golfers to have a lot of fun with miniature golf. At the same time, they're winding through the aisles and stacks and rooms of the library. It gives all of them a chance to see all the new things here at the library in terms of the areas they may never visit otherwise.
The course ends here at the 19th hole, where tasty concessions, face painting, and the chance to win a raffle basket continue the fun-loving family atmosphere.
We have 13 baskets all packaged up beautifully with all kinds of gift certificates and class offerings, both for children and adults. We're very grateful to the businesses that sponsor the event. Without their help, really, in terms of their donations and their generosity, we would not make a profit on this event. So we're expecting to generate a few thousand dollars that we can use again to offset program costs and even bring more programs to the table next year.
Mini golf at the Mount Prospect Public Library has become a signature fundraiser for the Library Foundation, which was founded in 1997.
The whole concept of developing a foundation is that we have a nonprofit charitable organization that works on behalf of the library to subsidize and sponsor programs that otherwise are not attainable from our tax dollars. And also, since that time, we've grown a significant endowment fund that we manage for future generations of the library.
We're big supporters of the foundation, actually, and we come to the library all the time. So anything that you guys have to offer, we're typically here.
We love our library. It keeps the kids busy, it's fun, it's entertaining, and we try to come for all of the Mount Prospect Library programs that they have.
We're trying to make a fun event for the community, for all to participate in. It would be great to make a lot of money, but that's not our primary goal. It's really to interact with the community and also to create some visibility for the foundation, let them know who we are and create awareness so that they realize how much goes into supporting the library and the programs that are offered here.
It was so good. I love it so much.
Spanning both popular and classical genres, the music of George Gershwin is perhaps the most beloved and well-known of the 20th century. Joining me today on Library Life to discuss her library event, George Gershwin, the American Composer, is musical biographer Susan Benjamin. Welcome.
Thank you, Kathy. Always good to be here.
Oh, I was about to say, it's always wonderful to have you. Susan, we've got a lot of ground to cover today with George Gershwin, but I'd like to start out by talking a little bit about your background as a musical biographer.
My career was, I was a high school English, speech, drama, and TV teacher, mm-hmm. and then most of my career I was a school administrator, English department chair at Highland Park High School for 10 years and assistant superintendent of District 113 for 10 years. When I retired, people started calling me and asking me to give different kinds of presentations. And the short version is that I ended up loving to do these musical biographies where I do pretty extensive research on either a performer or a composer's life and work. And then what I try to do in the presentation is bring that person to you, the audience. So at the end of the hour, you feel like you really know that person.
Well, let's get right into George Gershwin. I can't imagine that anybody out there doesn't know who George Gershwin is, but just in case, let's give a little introduction.
Okay, I call this program George Gershwin, the American composer, because he really was. I mean, he grew up in this country, and he took various idioms and put them together in an unusual kind of music. One critic called it the music of intoxication. Mm-hmm. But it was sort of a combination of jazz and classical music with even a little klezmer music thrown in. So that was George Gershwin and his works. Many people know Rhapsody in Blue, Porgy and Bess, many of his popular songs, Concerto and F. I mean, I really could go on and on.
Right.
But his works are quintessentially, I believe, American.
I agree, and you can always tell a Gershwin tune, in my opinion. There's just something about that.
Yes, it has a personality.
So let's start at the very beginning and talk a little bit about Gershwin's childhood and the family that he came from.
Well, here I am telling you he was the American composer, but both of his parents were born in Russia, Russia and the Ukraine, which was part of Russia, and they came over here in the 1890s. First, Rosa Brushkin and her family came over, and then Moshe Gershevitz followed her, and they married here. They got married in 1895, and the short version is, of course, they became Morris and Rose Gershwin. And their first child was Israel, called Izzy, and he became Ira. Mm-hmm. He was born in 1896, and the second one was Jacob. He became George, and he was born in 1898, and then there were two others. Arthur and Frankie, born, she's the girl, Frances. So there were four Gershwin children. Mm-hmm. And their childhood was characterized by moving around. By the time George was a teenager, he had lived in 35 New York area residences.
Oh my goodness.
The father had all sorts of jobs. He was sort of whimsical and naive. He would run a cigar store, and then he would cut leather, and he did all sorts of different things, candy store, and the mom was a bookkeeper. And this was unusual at the time. Both parents worked full-time, and she was tough, and she ran the family.
George really didn't come from a musical family, so when did he discover music?
His musical background really didn't start till he was about 10. He was a bad student. And he was cutting an assembly, and he was on the playground while the assembly was taking place in school, and he heard music from the assembly, and his friend Maxie Rosenzweig was playing a beautiful piece by Dvorak, and he listened to it, and then afterwards he came back into school and he said, Maxie, I want to learn to play the piano, and I'll accompany you. You play the violin, and I'll play the piano. And Maxie said to him, George, you have no talent for music, I can tell.
Oh my gosh.
But the Rosenzweig family had a piano, mm-hmm. and George, unknown to anybody in his family, after school would go and play the piano. And then when the Gershwin family bought a piano, and it was not for George, it was for Ira, the studious older brother, to learn to play, mm-hmm. George shocked everybody by sitting down and just playing the piano.
Oh my goodness.
Nobody knew he could play, and he was self-taught.
Obviously a natural.
Right.
So tell me, were George and Ira close?
They were close, but they were as different as night and day. You could hardly believe that they had grown up in the same house. George was outgoing and athletic and vivacious and mischievous, a bad student. Ira was a really good student, and he was very quiet, and he was very shy, and he wore glasses, and he viewed himself, Ira did, as sort of a bespectacled nerd. George did not view himself as a nerd. And Ira always admired George. He admired his big personality. He admired his confidence. But most of all, Ira admired his talent. Mm-hmm. Yet, nobody could write lyrics for George the way Ira could. George wrote everything fast. Yeah, people always wonder, what comes first, the music or the lyrics? With these brothers, the music came first. And then Ira was slowly taking his time, pondering over every word, would write the lyrics. And they were great.
Well, so let's talk about their early careers. They started in Tin Pan Alley, or at least George did.
George did. George, at the age of 15, he went to his mother and he said, I'm not good at school. I'm not getting anything out of school. Will you let me quit school? Mm-hmm. And Rose let him. And at 15, he went to Tin Pan Alley, and he was a song plugger. And he plugged songs for, you know, a Remick publishing house. And after a few years, he said to his mother, I'm a very unhappy lad, because as he was plugging those songs, he was writing some himself. And the publisher said, I'm not going to publish your songs. They're so dramatic. They're so overly romantic. But anyway, and when he was 19, he met this Irving Caesar. And in 10 minutes, over a coffee table in a coffee shop, they wrote the song called Swanee.
Yes.
Now, of everything that George Gershwin ever wrote, Swanee was the most successful thing he ever wrote. Can you believe that?
No, that is amazing.
Yes. Al Jolson heard it at a party.
Right.
Al Jolson said to George Gershwin, give me that song and I'll make it a hit, kid. So he did. He had Al Jolson sing it in a musical review, and Jolson changed the tempo and made it upbeat and fun, and we all know what happened.
Went to be a national hit.
There you go. I mean, but it was Jolson who made it a hit. It was not George Gershwin.
So let's talk a little bit about George Gershwin's transition to Broadway.
Well, he started writing for a series of reviews called George White's Scandals, different musical shows. And so he wrote a number of hits in George White's Scandals. And now at this point, he started working with Ira as his main lyricist. And so they were writing parts of shows and then shows together. But I think an interesting story from that era was they wrote songs that were a little autobiographical. And the one that was autobiographical about George was one that he felt about himself, which is, they're writing songs of love,
but not for me.
Mm-hmm. And the one about Ira was the one where the lyric is, although he may not be the man some girls think of as handsome. That lyric he wrote about himself, and he hardly ever wrote about himself. So you see, you've got songs from that era, 1920 to 25,
right,
where they're writing songs about, you know, they're beautiful,
they're gorgeous,
lasting
songs.
Yes. The Man I Love, one of the great songs. Mm-hmm. But they're somewhat, the lyrics are somewhat biographical about them and their feelings. And that was something they could do, that they could write songs that elicit feelings in you about your life and your emotions that actually they were feeling.
All right, now when did Porgy and Bess come into play?
Well,
here?
He was obsessed with this idea of writing an opera.
Right.
And this is now we're in the 30s, and he decided that he was going, he loved the novel Porgy by DeBose Hayward.
Right.
He moved himself from New York to Folly, South Carolina, which is, it's sort of close to Charleston, this little like fishing village, and he lived in a shack there for 20 months. So he could pick up the rhythm of the people and the boats and the fishing, and that's where he wrote the music to Porgy and Bess. And he thought that he was going to have DeBose Hayward, the author of Porgy, write the lyrics, and DeBose Hayward tried and failed. And then he called his brother Ira. Ira did not move down to Folly, South Carolina. From New York, he looked at his brother's music, and he wrote the most perfect lyrics. And so by the time it debuted, it was almost the mid-30s. When it debuted, it was tough for him, for George, because first, he only saw it with an authentic all-black cast. And when he started marketing it, people said, no, we'll do it in blackface and we'll star Al Jolson. He was like, no, this is not what I want. This is not authentic. So he didn't debut it in New York. He debuted it in Boston. eventually it moved to New York, but it initially did not get such good reviews.
But now it is like one of his masterpieces.
Oh, it's a masterpiece.
Yes, it is.
Just, I think it was 2 years ago, it won the Tony Award on Broadway again, you know.
Well, that music, how could you go wrong?
Oh, it's so unbelievable. People love it and respect the work now.
Now let's talk a little bit about his, he was an American in Paris for a while.
Yes,
so
he
let's
was.
Just talk a little bit about that particular era for him.
Okay, so he went to Paris for a while and you know, he wasn't just a composer. Mm-hmm. He was an artist, a visual artist. So if you see the movie An American in Paris, it's somewhat biographical because the fellow who is the American in Paris, played by Gene Kelly in the movie, that life is based on George Gershwin's time as a visual artist as well as a composer. Mm-hmm. And when he went to Paris, he thought, well, I'm going to find the great French composers and maybe I'll study with Rowell, for example. Everybody he approached really didn't want him as a student. You know, he wasn't an easy personality. Mm-hmm. So on his own, he just listened to the sounds of Paris, and he wrote, as we know, An American in Paris. And he was so innovative, he used the taxi horns as part of the instrumentation. Right. That's what makes it so, I hate to use the word unique, but it is unique that nobody else did that. Mm-hmm. And brought it back to the United States, and of course that was a major hit.
I know we got to kind of move on to his Hollywood years, and then unfortunately his illness, because we're running out of time. But so if we can just kind of
He moved to Hollywood, and like most really good composers, didn't love it because you would write songs, and you'd hand them over to the movie studio, and they would do whatever they wanted with them, and it wasn't always what you wanted. And the other thing is, he found himself writing what he would view as less important songs. He wasn't writing, like, Rhapsody in Blue, that was important work to him. He was writing for Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers and movies like Swing Time. He wrote for movies like The Goldwyn Follies. And it was okay for him, but he didn't view it as his most important work. While he was there, he was playing a concerto enough in Los Angeles, and he began to get a blinding headache, and his fingers weren't hitting the right keys. He didn't think too much about it. Happened again, and to make a long story short, he was diagnosed with a malignant brain tumor, and he died. He died July 11th, 1937.
At the age of 38?
38.
Oh, my goodness.
He was 38, and I had not quite reached 39. But the end of that story is really sort of poignant. So here he was. Remember I told you, he did everything fast.
Right.
Ira was slower. So he had written much of the music for The Goldwyn Follies. That was the movie they were working on at the time. Mm-hmm. And so he had written this tune, and Ira had not yet put lyrics to it. And then Ira did put lyrics to it, and the song is Our Love Is Here to Stay. A beautiful romantic song.
Right.
However, when people listen to it, they think it's a love story between a man and a woman. It's very clear, our love is here to stay.
Right.
It's not. That song was written by a brother, Ira, who was heartbroken beyond belief about the death of his brother. So if you listen to those lyrics again, the beautiful music that George had written, lovely lyrics that Ira wrote, but that's what it's about.
Oh, I never knew that.
Yeah.
It is just a beautiful story.
Yeah, it is. It is. Yeah. And so sad and so poignant. And that's how the Hollywood years ended, with a song that really transcended the movie it was in, The Goldwyn Follies, and became a hit on its own, and became one brother's tribute to his brother.
I just want to end by talking a little bit about what you might think would be George Gershwin's greatest accomplishment.
Well, I think his greatest accomplishment was that his music, he actually spanned so many genres, and it was always so different, and it was so alive, and it was so new, and it was so fresh, and that he could take all these idioms, as I said at the beginning, jazz, and even opera, and classical music, and klezmer, and put them together. So it's music that lasts, and it's music that is ours, and it's truly American. And I love it, and I love him for that.
Well, I want to thank you so much for being with me again. It's always a pleasure.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Kathy.
For more information regarding George Gershwin or any upcoming Mount Prospect Public Library event, call the library at area code 847-253-5675 or visit our website at www.mppl.org. Playtime at the library features an assortment of entertaining educational activities children can share with their caregivers. Here's a look at this engaging ongoing series. It's 9:30 on a Tuesday morning, a great time for children 6 and under to gather with their caregivers for a little playtime at the library.
One of the ways that children learn is, of course, through play, and we want to give them opportunities to do hands-on activities, focusing on different kinds of skills, different kinds of play, and it's a chance for parents, grandparents, caregivers to interact with the children with these activities that focus on, you know, science and math and language and all different kinds of skills that the kids can get.
On this particular day, participants are experiencing the seasons of the year through a series of hands-on interactive stations thoughtfully prepared by library staff members.
We have some pretend snow that we've made. You know, we found the recipe online, and it's just like shampoo and baking soda, and it feels like snow, and it's a really fun sensory experience. And then we also have a pretend garden. Make-believe play is a great way to learn language skills. We have a craft station where they'll decorate leaves for fall, and then they'll put it up on a mural. Playing with the arts is a great thing for all kids. And we also have a sponge boat racing station, so a little bit of water and science play there.
A felt board, building blocks, and parachute play complete the activities available during this hour and a half long open-ended program, which enables everyone to drop in and leave at their convenience.
These experiences are helping them learn language skills that will help them with reading when they get to school. They're also developing their large motor, small motor skills, and a lot of kids need some sensory experiences to help them learn. So we focus on that. We always have at least one sensory station.
It's a wonderful activity. Lots of different sensory activities, water, beans, the shaving cream, especially things that parents don't always like to bring out at home because it gets messy. It's here for the kids at the library, and they get to all play together.
But we love it. We do story time here every week, and this gives them a little bit more to do, a little bit more hands-on.
We have signage that explains the activities and why it's beneficial for the kids, and also some tips for how to use some of the things that we put out. I think our primary goal is just to reinforce early literacy skills as well as other child development as far as motor skills and just learning opportunities that maybe don't feel like learning opportunities. They're just play.
From mini golf to playtime at the library, family experiences are prevalent here at the Mount Prospect Public Library, as are books about the family experience. Here's Head of Circulation Services Janine Sarto with her best book pick on this topic from the Adult Services Department.
This is what I want. I want to grab my brother's hand and run back through time, losing years like coats falling from our shoulders. Twins Noah and Jude are inseparable, until suddenly they aren't. Alternating between Noah at age 13 and Jude at age 16, I'll Give You the Sun by Jandy Nelson explores the before and the after of something that completely changes both of their lives. Noah at age 13 is falling in love with the boy next door, drowning himself in creativity and art, and letting his outgoing twin sister Jude take the spotlight. At 16, the tables have turned for the twins, with Noah playing the role of popular, confident jock as Jude has folded in on herself. isolated herself not only from Noah, but from most of the world around her. What caused the once close twins to pull away from each other and each change so drastically over the course of 3 years? Can they ever regain the relationship that they once had? I'll Give You the Sun is equal measures breathtaking, heartbreaking, and uplifting. Noah's vibrant descriptions of his self-portraits really come to life as you read and infuse the story with a sense of magic and exuberance. Jude's attempts to make sense of the curveballs life has thrown her are equally powerful as she comforts herself with superstitions that rule her world. This is a beautiful and unique book about love, loss, fate, truth, magic, and the connections we have to one another and the world around us. Jude and Noah will work their way into your heart and stay with you long after the final page.
Recommendations from the Adult Services Department this month focus on family and self-exploration. How to Save a Life by Sara Zarr tells the tale of two young women from very different circumstances who must stretch their comfort zones when their worlds collide. In Eleanor and Park by Rainbow Rowell, a weird new girl at school and a shy boy bond over comic books and forge a relationship neither saw coming. Will Grayson, Will Grayson by John Green and David Levithan surrounds the incident of two people with the same name meeting and the effects that follow. In Tell the Wolves I'm Home by Carol Rifka Brunt, a young girl befriends the roommate of a beloved dead relative and learns more about herself and her family than she ever thought possible. And in Boy Meets Boy by David Levithan, a high school student and his friends face typical teenage problems while searching for happiness. Recommendations from the Youth Services Department this month are stories about sisters. In The Penderwigs by Jean Birdsall, four sisters go on vacation with their father and experience a summer they will never forget. West of the Moon by Margie Prius is the tale of two sisters who set off for a better life in America, armed with a troll treasure, a book of spells, and perhaps a magic hairbrush. In A Nearer Moon by Melanie Crowder, an heroic girl tries every measure possible to save her sick younger sister. Safi's Angel by Hillary McKay centers around a 13-year-old girl who learns she is adopted, and with the help of the only family member she has ever known, embarks on a quest to find her roots. And in The Sisters Grimm, The Fairy Tale Detectives by Michael Buckley, two siblings with famous ancestors take on the responsibility of investigating what family members believe to be not fairy tales, but a collection of magical mischief case files. Finally, here's Programming Outreach Assistant Amy Schlachter with her best book pick from the Youth Services Department.
The Truth About Twinkie Pie by Kat Yeh is the story of Galileo Galilei Barnes, shortened to Gigi for obvious reasons. Gigi and her older sister Dee Dee moved from an old trailer park in South Carolina to Long Island, New York, after Dee Dee won $1 million in a cooking contest. The girl's mother died in a fire when Gigi was just a baby, and the sisters have been living on their own ever since. All they have left of their mother is her prized cookbook. Dee Dee is determined to provide a better life for Gigi than the life they had back in South Carolina. As Gigi starts seventh grade at her new prestigious private school, Hill Prep, she is determined to reinvent herself. Gigi puts together her own recipe for success, which includes making real friends for the first time and being the girl Mama would be if she were here. Friendly, funny, confident. On the first day of school, Gigi literally bumps into handsome and popular Trip. He is friendly and kind and helps Gigi to feel comfortable at her new school. Her friendship with Trip, however, does not make popular girl Mace happy, and a rivalry between the two girls begins. The Truth About Twinkie Pie unfolds as Gigi begins to learn more about herself, her mother, and her sister. This is a heartwarming story of love, loss, sacrifice, and what it means to be a family. Each chapter of The Truth About Twinkie Pie begins with a recipe from Mama's cookbook, which adds to the charm of this middle grade novel. Readers who like character-driven stories with a bit of mystery are sure to enjoy The Truth About Twinkie Pie.
The Dennehy Irish Dancers are always a popular Super Saturday event here at the Mount Prospect Public Library. Let's enjoy a taste of this toe-tapping family experience. Jigs and reels abound here at the Mount Prospect Public Library as the Dennehy Irish Dancers take the stage, mesmerizing a full house of fascinated library patrons.
The kids are going to do some dance numbers in their light shoes. We are going to do a couple of hard shoe numbers, but it's just a lot of partner dances, a lot of upbeat music.
Dance instructor Kathy Horan has been with the Dennehy School of Irish Dance, which is located on Chicago's South Side, since her days as a student more than 30 years ago.
The Dennehy Irish Dancers was one of the first dance schools in the Chicago area. It was started by Dennis and Marge Dennehy probably 60 years ago. Their daughter Kathy then took over the dance school, and I was a student there, and when I was 16 I started helping teach with her.
This Super Saturday event features 18 Dennehy students, ranging in age from 6 to 13.
A lot of life lessons are learned in Irish dancing. You know, it's great confidence for the kids when they're dancing out in front of an audience. I think as they're getting older, that helps them be more comfortable, you know, when they're maybe speaking publicly or stuff like that. I think too, with competition, you know, you have to learn to win and lose graciously. So I do think there's a lot of life lessons that are to be learned from Irish dancing.
These young troopers perform a variety of Irish dance numbers, brandishing intricate steps in both soft and hard shoes.
The light shoes are more like kind of ballet type shoes. They just have more laces. And the hard shoes have the fiberglass tips, so they make the noise, more powerful dancing than the light shoes.
As reoccurring performers here at the Mount Prospect Public Library, the Dennehy Irish Dancers know this program just wouldn't be complete without a mini dance lesson to wrap up the fun.
Pick that foot up.
It's a great form of entertainment for people that come here to see the show today.
The Dennehy Irish Dancers are just one example of the many entertaining, informational, and educational events featured here at the Mount Prospect Public Library every month. Don't miss any library programs you'd like to experience. Here's a list of events scheduled in April and May. Reservations are strongly recommended. For more information regarding these events, call area code 847-253-5675 or visit our website at www.mppl.org. You'll also find a listing and description of all upcoming Mount Prospect Public Library events in your library newsletter preview. Earlier in this program, we explored the life and accomplishments of George Gershwin. With this in mind, our Library Life camera today asks the question, who is your favorite American composer and why? Here are some responses.
Cole Porter. The lyrics and the music all fit, and the lyrics just have such a ring and a lilt to them.
Irving Berlin, because I love all his old, you know, patriotic songs and makes me feel good.
George Gershwin, I just like the music.
That wraps up this edition of Library Life. For more information on any of the Mount Prospect Public Library services and events highlighted here, call area code 847-253-5675 or visit our website at www.mppl.org.